love the surprises of the Lord when his manifest presence just goes kaboom. Just lands on you when you're pulling up to Walmart. Or just lands on you when you finish getting off the phone praying for your sister. Or just lands on you after you go to a worship service and you worship your heart out, but you still want more, and then he goes kaboom when you're driving home. I love the suddenlies of the Lord with the manifest presence of God. Just goes kaboom. I love the kaboom of the Lord. Holy Shaka. Oh, Shaka God, I thank you for the kaboom of the Lord. The slug of the Lord. One time my friend came over. We worshiped all night. That's all we did. We just worshiped the Lord. And then this realm was opened up and we just sat there and we revelated. We just quoted scriptures and spoke phrases of wisdom, and understanding was there because the air was clean and clear. And even my wife that was sleeping, she was getting plastered in the room. She wasn't even in the living room. She was in the bedroom trying to sleep, and the presence of God was just rolling in throughout the entire house. She got kaboomed by the Lord. And we just I might have recorded it way back there in the archives. This was like a few years ago. I used to have like these crazy meetings in my house, and it'd be just screaming and loud shouting and shouts of praise to the Lord. Our poor neighbors, I think they actually liked it though. So me and my friend were revelating, and he just felt from the Lord that he wasn't supposed to talk. He was supposed to let Chris talk for a while. It was such an intense night of revelation and intoxication of the glory, like literally the glory, the anointing. Thank you, God, for the peace and all the sauce. We played the happy song. I was playing the drums and he was playing guitar, and we just worshiped God with all of our might, all of our minds, all of our souls, all of our spirits, all of our body. Just praise the Lord with everything we had. And then it was time to go, because we were praising probably like for 4 hours, and you know, we get hungry, you gotta feed the earth suit, and got work the next day and stuff. And so my friend was going down the stairs to go home, because we were worshiping in the living room this particular time. And he just stopped at the door. It's like, whoa. there's a lot of glory here. And I went down the stairs, and there was literally a lot of glory, just boom. And so he never left. We stood there for like 10 to 15 minutes in the doorway, just whoa. We were being still and knowing he was God. God's presence was manifest so strong. And then we got the door open and we saw God's creation. There was a slug. He was just slowly moving along the sidewalk, enjoying the manifest presence of God with us. It felt like Noah's Ark, where the animals were even coming to the Ark. And so we had this thing, it's like, wow, the slug of Yahweh. Yahweh made him. And he enjoyed the manifest presence of God. You know, all creation was crying out for the manifestations of the sons of God. The sons of God manifest God. So that's why creation's waiting in anticipation, eagerly longing for the manifestation of the sons of God. And so finally we stood stood there for about another 10 minutes staring at the slug of Yahweh. That was an extended meeting of just no schedule, we didn't have to do anything. All we did, we wanted God, and then God just showed up. And that slug of Yahweh was so prophetic. He had his little two antenna things up. It's like his hands were surrendered in worship to the Lord. He left a trail of sauce. He left a trail of sauce behind him. It's like that's what a son of God is supposed to do. He's supposed to leave a trail of the presence of the Lord, the fragrance of God. Surely these men have been with the Lord, you know. You can tell by the trail that they're leaving behind them. There's a lot of glory and dripping oil. Even Job 29 says, I remember the days when I bathed my steps in butter. My steps were like just caked with butter, oily, anointed, walking in the anointing. Yeah, so we had a lot of fun that night, just looking at the slug of Yahweh, revelating. But it all came because of us, suddenly. Like, we enjoyed ourselves in the presence, but his presence goes before him. His presence comes before the glory shows up when you just stand there in awe. Stand there in awe at God's creation. Hallelujah. Oh, I love those encounters with nature. One time I was in this other church. I was trying to practice my faith, exercise my faith. And I saw a little bumblebee inside the window. And I thought, well, you know what? I'm full of God. I'm going to go lay hands on that bee and raise him from the dead. Because he was dried up and he looked like he was dead. So I thought, well, they raised the dead in the Bible. And so I went over there. Spirit of fear hit me. What if he's still alive? What if he stings you? All these things are going through my mind as I stare at this bee. I'm like, well, I'm just going to take authority over this little guy. I rebuke you, spirit of fear. And I gathered up all this. I mustered up a lot of courage. I took this authoritative finger. I laid it on. I was like ready to cast the devil out of the spirit of death out of this bee. I'm not gonna take nothing. I could feel the fear. It was in my emotions, and it was like I had to break through it. I said, in the name of Jesus, live! And I crunched, and it scared me, and I just ran out of there screaming like a little girl. I had some more growing to do. But that wasn't my first encounter with nature, you know, with little bugs and stuff like that. Because I had this other encounter where this guy was preaching and it was good. I don't know what he preached about, but I remember the Holy Spirit. Yeah, that's what he preached about. He was preaching about the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, we just welcome your peace. We welcome your spirit to flood through our hearts, God, flood through our minds, flood through our ear gates, flood through our hands, flood through your body of Christ, God. Yeah, crucify everyone's flesh and emotions. Put it to death in Christ and let your spirit rise up within us and out through us like a living water, like a living waterfall to the earth. Hallelujah, Shabbat. So I'm sitting in this, meeting. He's talking about the Holy Spirit and angels and the power of God. And you can feel the atmosphere is full of God. And he said these angels just pinned him to the ground and they were really strong. But it was the glory, the weighty glory that just held him to the ground. And he could see the angels. And he was like, angels, angels. And then he was giving this testimony. He was talking about the angels. I like the angels. I love Jesus more. But I like pastors too when they're full of the Holy Ghost. I'm not going to dismiss angels or dismiss a pastor. They're just like my spiritual friends, you know. So, whatever. And as he's talking about the angels and stuff, and he invites us to the front if we want to get to know Holy Spirit, because that's what the whole thing was about. The whole meeting was about Holy Spirit. And I, as soon as I went to the front, there was like this altar, it was like stairs. And I knelt down and I could feel this beautiful anointing, this beautiful presence of God. And it just went right through. Oh man, I could have sat there for eternity and be absolutely 100% fully satisfied. If it didn't increase or if it didn't lessen, I would just sit there in His presence. That's all I want. Just to sit in His presence. Just to even hear His voice is just like, that's the greatest privilege anyone could ever have, is to hear the voice of God. But the Holy Spirit was there and He was filling me. He was filling the people around me. He was filling the body. He was filling us. And because that's what we went up to the front for, is to meet with Holy Spirit. And as I'm getting absolutely hammered in the Holy Ghost, there's this little ant. He's crawling along. And I was like, I'm going to touch him, for creation groans for the manifestation of the sons of God. I want to touch him, God, and I ask that you touch this ant. Fill him with your peace. You know, all creation. Why not the flowers sing in heaven? Why can't ants feel the peace of God? So, as I'm absolutely plastered in the Holy Ghost, I'm like, there's this time, there is a lot of power. It wasn't just kind of trying to stir up a gift or anything. I'm in the sauce, man, and this ant is crawling. And then I put my hand on him. I'm like, touch. And he stood up, he looked at me, looked at me, and he fell out in the Spirit, man. He fell backwards, man, with his little hands going out like that. It was just like the stuff that you see like on Benny Hinn, you know, on the TV. I couldn't believe it. He stood up on his hind legs and he fell backwards like that, and he fell off the altar. I couldn't find him. I hope no one stepped on him, but he would have died a happy ant if someone did. So, man, I love God and all of His creatures, man. That ant got touched by the Lord. Hallelujah, man. Yeah, I think Proverbs says that go to the wisdom of the ant, or ants have wisdom or something, whatever. Hallelujah. My dog. I used to have this dog named Coco. I'm allergic to dogs, but he had special fur. It took me a while to get used to him because the allergies kind of settled down. He was a Yorkie. And those dogs have like special hair, so it doesn't make you sneeze as bad. And so I had this dog, but I trained him wrong. These are just stories with animals, I guess. I trained him wrong. I tried to potty train him, and no one told me how to do it. I just learned from what I seen other people do. And he would take a poo in the living room, and I would wipe his nose in it. Don't ever do that. That's not how you teach a dog not to poo in the living room. I felt so bad about it, but... later on I taught him how to do it properly, that you positive reinforcements by giving him treats. And I actually, we had the papers, we paper trained him in the bathroom, and I showed him how to do it. And he learned from example. I just peed on the newspapers and gave myself a treat. I showed him how to do it, and he did. I'm like, good boy, I gave him a treat, you know, positive reinforcement. And then he learned how to go to the bathroom in the bathroom, and then I taught him how to go outside too. Well, no, you don't teach them, they just know how to go outside, it's natural. But anyways, this dog felt like I didn't like him. And it was weird because I walked by him and I felt the vibe. It's like, I felt like he's, oh, you don't love me. I felt like he said that. He didn't say it, but it's just like, he's like, oh, you don't love me. And, that kind of hurt my heart a little bit. This is years ago. And the person that was beside me said exactly what I thought the dog said. This person told me, yeah, your dog thinks that you don't love him. I was like, whoa, I just thought that he thought that. And so... my heart was hurting, like it physically hurt my heart. My heart was physically hurting. And so what I did is I went and grabbed my dog. I told him, I said, I love you. I'm sorry for rubbing your nose in poo-poo. I love you. And I gave him a big hug. I hugged my dog. I felt love go through my heart and touch him. And the pain instantly stopped in my heart. Oh man, there is so much in that. It's like your heart was created to love. And usually if there's pain in your heart, you need to just open it up in love. You need to love God. Open up your heart and just love God. Open up your heart and love people through prayer. Just open up your heart. Like, it's the beast nature. Even beast nature is Christians. So open up your heart and just pour out words that will just like bring them into the glory, you know. Just pray for them as if you'd want someone to pray for you when you were in bondage. And so, that dog knew, man. And maybe part of me, I was a little bit angry because he was, he would poo on the floor and stuff like that. If you're going to get an animal, you got to have a lot of patience. It's like having a kid, just less maintenance, but you still got to love them unconditionally. No matter if they chew up your furniture, still got to love them, discipline them, but do it in love. Hallelujah. I had this other dog named Kuma. Man, this dog loved me. This dog loved me, man. I raised him from a little pup. And since he was 3 months old, God used him to teach me some stuff too. This is kind of really humbling, but I'm going to tell you anyway. I used to I'd rub his belly, and he would love that. He loved that since he was a baby pup. And he would always come to me. I'm the guy, because I was his master, you know. I look after him, and I feed him, and teach him how to give high fives, and I taught him all these tricks, and... And he went up to one of my friends came over, and he goes up to him. He goes, and that means he wants a belly rub. So I'm like, you're like, what's your dog doing, man? Is he hungry? He's like, no, he wants you to give him a belly rub. It's like, okay, he didn't really like dogs. He's just kind of like that. So, and then whenever my dog would do that, that means he just wants a belly rub. He wants some attention. He wants some love. And so, long story short, I was exercising one day, and 333 means Jeremiah 33 verse 3 to me. And as I was exercising, I had this stepper. I got it for $20 or something, or $10. I don't remember what I paid for it, from like a secondhand store. And I just brought it home. It had these rubber bands on it, so I thought I was just gonna get into shape, and be Superman's big brother. And so I'm exercising on this thing. Obviously you could tell it didn't work, but and then it stopped at 333, and I looked down about it, and it kind of like the 333 just exploded, and I knew that meant Jeremiah 33 verse 3. You can hear all my other testimonies of how God used that number to explain what it means to me. And so I'm like, oh man, but I don't want to go pray right now. I think I'll just finish exercise. Maybe I'll get up to 555. You know? And that's not the way it works, man. God wants to talk to me. So I just kind of I got to pull away from all these distractions. And I went into my prayer room, which was just this little workout room thing that I had. And I went in there, and I'm like, God, what's going on? You know, I'm just praying. I'm seeking God, and nothing. It's dry. It's dry as going into a religious ceremony. Where's the presence of God, man? And so I'm looking for the presence of God. I don't see nothing. I don't hear nothing. I don't feel nothing. I was like, oh man, maybe I just missed it. Maybe this number thing is just I've just gotta start, focus on the Bible more or something. All these numbers are just driving me crazy. But maybe this was the Lord calling me. I don't know. I'm like, God, what? What is it? And I'm like, I stopped everything, and I got really still before the Lord. I didn't pray anymore. I just God, what is it? You called me in here. What is it? I'm listening. And you know what? I heard my dog go, like, what is going on with my mind, man? Are you serious, God? And the scripture popped in my mind about the woman with the you know, even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table. I was like, is God, are you, like, you know, I'm thinking, like, is God testing me to see how hungry I am for him, that if I would even just have a crumb? Do I want him more than my pride? I was thinking, would I do anything for God? And I was like, I don't even know if this is even right to do. So, like, everything inside of me, like, said, I need to do that because I want God's attention. Even though I already have God's attention, I'm just making this all up in my mind. I don't even know. Why did I hear my dog whine in my mind? And I'm like, you know what? I'm so hungry for God right now. I don't even care. I don't even care if I look stupid. You know what I did? To God, this is what I said. I stopped praying, and this is what I said to God, because it meant that I want a belly rub. I want attention. I want some love. I went. And God honored that faith. The presence of God just went boom, right through me. Am I a Gentile dog? I don't even know what. It was so beyond my understanding. It didn't even matter. It was just saying, God, I don't even care what I am, if I'm a piece of dust or if I'm glory dust or if I'm a son of God or just a slave of the Lord. It doesn't even matter. I just want you. It was a cry of intimacy. And my dog, man. And it was humbling, but and it was stretching. And as I did that, I stretched myself to humble myself even more, that I don't even really care about my life at all whatsoever. Am I the great Chris Radical Man in the Valley? Or am I just like, it doesn't matter. It's no longer me living at all. I just want God. I just want Christ living in me, the hope of glory. I just want Christ in me. I want Christ through me. And when I whimpered like a little dog, like my dog, God gave me a belly rub in the spirit. It's like his love just poured through my entire being, and I just sat there and wept in the manifest presence of God. I don't even care what people think. That's why I'm telling all you guys. It was a stretching, and I have a whole teaching about it hidden within Genesis chapter 12. I might even share it with you after I talk about what happened. Anyways, as I'm like just weeping in the manifest presence of God, nothing could pull me away from that. Like, even if there was a fire in the house and I would have burned, I would have died. I would have died there in the manifest presence of God. Because somebody was bang, 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 Chris, bang, bang, bang. They're banging on my door. And I didn't say anything. I didn't want to say anything. I was in the manifest presence of God, and nobody could pull me out. Not even an emergency. This bang, bang, bang. They were there for like 2 minutes, banging on the door. Chris, I don't care. What you think is important is not as important as what's happening right now. I'm spending time with God. I don't even care if like, you know, all the dogs died. Like, just, I'm dying to myself right now. But I'm in the manifest presence of God. And that's all that matters. He's all that matters. And so, like, I came out of that. And then God was giving me a teaching, because the pastor at the church that I was going to every week, I was leading worship there, and the pastor wanted me to stretch me. It says, like, you're going to bring the word of the Lord for the next 3 weeks. Okay. During the Bible study, we had the Bible study on Fridays. It wasn't the Sunday services. And so, yeah, I guess I'll teach you what the Lord taught me. Just a sec. I wrote it all down in my Bible. Right here. Look at the notes on this guy. could see that, but there's a lot of scribbles and stuff. And I woke up one morning, I think it was that morning, and God opened up Abraham. I think I saw it in a vision or something. I can't remember the revelation, how it came about. But this is what God wanted me to teach on. And it was the King James, and it was almost like the words that I had to take it out of context to see what he was saying behind the scriptures, in between the lines to me personally. It was strange. Like a Baptist would rebuke me for twisting the scriptures, because that's not what the original says, you know. But I'll tell you, it was God talking to me in a way that I could hear. And this is what he said to me. This is Genesis chapter 12. And I'll tell you about the stretching part later. I mean, whining like a dog. This all sounds like so. Where's that in the Bible, you know? Here, chapter 12, Genesis. Can you tell that I don't really care? I only care that my father, what my father thinks, and he's well pleased that he gave me this thing to share with a Bible study, and here, this is what it's all about. I think I called it Keys to the Abiding Presence of God or something like that. Genesis chapter 12. Now the Lord had said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land I will show thee. So, let me see here. These are just keys to like walking with God. Keys to the abiding presence of God. Keys to walking with God. We'll just call it that. Keys to walking with God. Now the Lord had said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee. Holy Spirit, I just welcome you to just, yeah, get us jacked up in this teaching here and release more revelation. If you want to add to it, or if you want to take some away, we give this teaching into your hands right now, God, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Listen, the first thing for walking with God, one of the keys is right there in the very second sentence. Now the Lord had said unto Abram, get thee out. The first thing that needs to get out is your fallen nature. You, get thee out of thy country. Like, that part jumped out at me. Get thee out. Get out of the way. Get your selfishness out of the way. Get crucified with Christ so that you can live and he can live through you. First thing that needs to go if you want to walk with God is your selfish opinions. Get thee out. Also, even look further to the very beginning. Now the Lord had said unto Abraham. One of some of the greatest keys to walking with God. Now the Lord said to Abraham. Abraham could hear his voice. Abraham heard the voice of God. Keys to being a friend with God. Now the Lord said to Abraham. Can you hear God's voice? Or do you depend upon your preacher to teach you about God? You need to hear God yourself if you're a wise virgin. The foolish virgins wanted to bum oil off of the wise. You can't get your vision from someone else. You have to get it from God yourself. Now the Lord said unto Abram, listen, God, if God will speak to Abram, he'll speak to you in Christ. My sheep know me and they know my voice, or whatever, you know what Jesus said. Hallelujah. Get thee out of thy country. Thy country? Like, that's the place where I'm familiar, God. I have to get out of my country where I'm familiar? Like, do we seek a heavenly country? How about get your mindset out of the earthly things and set it on things above? Get thee out of thy country. Why don't you get into heaven? Why don't you get into Christ? Why don't you get into heavenly places in Christ so that you can see from that perspective? And then you live from that perspective. And you'll have life overflowing through you to bring, you know, life to everyone around you. There's a lot of life on that right now. Hallelujah. And it gets even more intense. Out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house. All your friends, your father's house. Didn't Jesus say, call no man father on the earth, for one is your father who is in heaven? It's like it's a paradigm shift in your thinking. Get from thy kindred or from thy father's house. All those things that are familiar to you, you have to, like, it's just like you get a fresh new page. If any man be in Christ, behold, all things are new. The old things have passed away. Consider them as dead, so that you can walk in the new way. Yahweh, Christ is the way. You walk in His way. You walk in Him and let Him do the works. Holy Spirit. There's a lot of glory on that. Shabbat. From thy father's house unto a land I will show thee. Unto a land I will show thee. God, if you want keys to being a friend with God, unto a land I will show thee. That means He's speaking to you now. You're getting vision, and there's going to be provision for your vision. Unto a land I will show thee. God's not just going to speak to you once. It's a continual relationship. You go from glory to glory. You can enter realms of glory now. You don't just stop at that realm of glory. You just obey the blueprints that God's given you now, and you take that level of glory and you go to the next level of glory. God's promising more vision. He says, a land I will show you. God's going to show you fresh revelation if you step out and obey your old revelation. You know, you obey what God's given you, and God will take you to the next level. Land I will show you. So this is a relational journey. This is like, you can hear from God now, but it's like, did you ever hear from God like maybe 20 years ago or something like that, or 5 years ago you had a vision, or three years ago you had an encounter with the Lord? Well, what about now? Like, what about today? What about yesterday? Listen, there's a promise here. If you do what God said, you can go from glory to a land that I will show thee. It means like you're stepping out by faith. You're leaving everything that's familiar to you, and you're entering into the unknown. You walk by faith, not by sight. And I will make of thee a great nation. Wow. God's going to multiply you. If you get thee out, God will multiply your talents. I'll make of thee a great nation. I will bless thee. Remember? It's not that Abraham had to try and bless himself. It's God's going to bless thee. God said that He's going to bless Abraham. I will make of thee a great nation. Remember what he's leaving though? He's leaving his country. Get out of thy country. He's trading it for a nation. And I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. Let's read the first two all over again. And I will make of thee a great nation. I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. God is going to make Abraham's name great. Not Abraham by anything that he did. The only thing that Abraham could do to make his name great is to obey God, so that God can make his name great. Why? So that he can be a blessing. God wants to bless people through those who obey him. God uses those who listen and obey him to bless others around them. Verse 3, and I will bless them that bless thee, and I will curse him that curses thee, and in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed. In thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed. I will bless them that bless you, and I will curse them that curse you, Abraham. And in you shall all the families of the earth be blessed. God is going to, like, there's going to be such a heightened, quickened glory realm on Abraham that whoever blesses him will receive a blessing because they're sowing into the glory. And whoever curses him, because the glory realm is there and God, he's like walking with God, whoever curses him, those same curses will roll onto their own heads. Because that's what the glory does. It accelerates your words, whatever you say. So it's good to bless, especially those who do things that you don't understand. And if they're walking in the glory and you're cursing them, those words will fall back on your own head. And if you bless them, well, you'll receive a blessing, because you're sowing, and you reap what you sow. So sow blessing, sow glory, sow anointing, sow peace. You'll reap it. Anyway, so Abram departed. Wow. I wrote in my notes that it's a parallel to Jesus. So all the families of the earth shall be blessed. It's like, you're going to be like Jesus, man. Because everyone in Christ now is blessed. The curse is removed. Anyways, verse 4. So Abraham departed as the Lord had spoken unto him. If you want to be God's friend and walk with him in the glory, here's another key. Abraham walked in obedience. So Abraham departed as the Lord had spoken unto him. He obeyed. Obedience always brings promotion when you obey the Spirit of the Lord. That's a great creed of friendship, is just do what God says, man. So are you obedient to the Lord? I'm asking myself. I hope so. God, if there's anything that you've spoken to me that I've not done, then just I repent right now and I'll do it. Just bring it fresh to my memory. Bring it fresh to my memory. Even as I lay down in the night watches. Hallelujah. And Lot went with him, and Abram was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran. Haran means parched. So he departed out of a parched land. Anyways, and Abram took Sarai his wife, and Lot his brother's son, and their substance that they had gathered, and the souls that they had gotten in Haran. And they went forth into the land of Canaan. Okay, this is where that thing comes in. Canaan means that humbles and subdues. You want to walk with God? You need to be humble. Humble means full dependence upon Holy Spirit. Especially if you're going to, you know, obey Him. Like, you can't, whatever, yeah, humbles. Went forth in the land of Canaan, in the land of Canaan they came. So Abraham passed through the land unto the place of Shechem, which means portion, unto the plain of Moreh, which means stretching. And the Canaanite was then in the land. So in Moreh, that's where I felt like I was when I was just like doing the little puppy dog thing. That stretched me greatly, man. I even told everyone at the Bible study what happened to me that day. And but there was a lot of glory. Even one of the girls, as I was giving this Bible study, one of the girls, I was like, "Whoa, I can feel the presence of God." It was just confirmation that what I was experiencing was from God. It was the truth. We need to go through stretching if you want to be pliable. If you want to have the new wine gets poured into new wineskins so that the wineskins can stretch. Old wineskins are usually like, they're very stiff. They're not very flexible. Listen, you need to be like a new wineskin every day, ever being stretched by the Lord. It doesn't matter what you want to do. It just matters what God wants to do. And if it stretches you, then that's part of the walk. That's part of the keys of walking with God. You need to be humble. You need to hear Him. You need to obey Him. And God is going to bless you so that you can be a blessing, because you'll have Christ's nature. So under the plain of Moreh, which means stretching. And the Canaanite was then in the land. Let me read my notes here. You can only stretch so far at a time, or your arms might come off. I don't know where I got that revelation from, but whatever. I don't know if that's a revelation. I guess I'm still growing. Hallelujah. And the Lord appeared unto Abram and said, "Unto thy seed I will give this land." Hallelujah. You know what? You step out in faith and obey, and look, God gave him another piece. "Unto thy seed I will give this land." And there builded he an altar unto the Lord who appeared to him. So what's another key to walking with God, in the friendship with God, in the peace of God? Sacrifice. He built an altar unto the Lord who appeared to him. He sacrificed to the Lord. Sometimes God wants us to sacrifice our very own lives to lay on the altar and just let him burn up let's do it right now. We're walking with God. God, I just lay on the altar right now, and everyone who's pressed play, I just burn us up, God. All of you, Holy Spirit, none of us. All of you, God, all of you. Live your life freely through us, God. We just lay on the altar, burn us with the holy fire from heaven. Put the coals of fire on our mouths so that we only speak life. Put the coals of fire on our minds so that we only think with the mind of Christ. Put the coals of fire on our eyes so we have fresh vision. Put the coals of fire on our ears so we all hear what the Spirit is saying and not what the flesh is saying. Put to death the deeds of the flesh. Burn it all up, God. Thank you, God. Just consume us with the fire of God. Burn, 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 burn in our hearts. Burn in our hearts. Just like when they were walking with you on the road. Yeah, let the word of God burn in our hearts, God. Thank you. We just sacrifice everything again. I surrender all. And I surrender all. Well, it's kind of weird because the music is playing a different melody, but you get the gist, Lord. Hallelujah. I surrender all. And if I'm holding on to anything that displeases you, I freely give it, God. Because I want to walk with you as a friend. Because Abraham was the father of faith or something like that. Anyways. Sacrifice. We need to sacrifice everything that is doesn't produce life. Oh man, Shabbat. Where are we here? Shaka. Who appeared to him? So he kind of honored what God done there. Anyways, and he removed from thence. And removed from thence unto a mountain on the east of Bethel. Bethel means house of God. And pitched his tent, having Bethel on the west and Hai on the east. And there he built an altar unto the Lord and called upon the name of the Lord. So he built another altar, he sacrificed, and there he called upon the name of the Lord. It would be stupid to walk with God and not ever talk to him. He called upon the name of the Lord. He needed him. He needed more of Jesus, more of the Lord in our lives. So he called upon the name of the Lord. You know that whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You know what saved means? Healed, saved, delivered. You don't just get fire insurance, you get your soul healed. You get your spirit healed. You get saved, healed. You get your bodies healed. You get your soul, your mind healed. You get a brand new mind. That's what covenant is. Hold on, let's pause it. Let's put the brakes on at verse 9. Getting saved is not just you don't go to hell. It's like you get heaven implanted within, like you got heaven in you now. And you need to release the kingdom of heaven within you, out through you. It's not just like waiting till you die. You've already died and risen with Christ in the glory. Being saved is like being sozoed. You're healed in your body. You're healed in your soul. You're healed in your spirit. Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. What was lost? It was, yeah, just people lost their salvation, but it was so much more than that. They lost their walk with God. They lost, all men have sinned and fallen short of the glory. They sinned and fallen short of the glory. What was lost? The glory. Man walking in the glory. Man walking with God in the cool of the day. That's what was lost. He came to seek and to restore and to save, heal, save, deliver. Jesus came to bring us back into the Father. He is the way back. You can go through him and be healed, saved, delivered. Read the entire New Testament. Read the entire Bible. Everything that Jesus did and manifested, that's available for us. He went about healing all who are sick. Demon possessed in the mind, in their soul. Like their minds were tormented and they got healed. Instantly clarity. He had an awesome relationship with the Father. Healy said, I only say what I hear my Father saying, I only do what I see. He can hear and he can see. He had a perfect relationship with his Father. That's what he came to give us. An awesome relationship with the Father. Abraham was just like a foreshadow almost of what's to come. Hallelujah. I don't even think Abraham said a sinner's prayer. He just walked with God. Hallelujah. He turned from sin. He obeyed God. And he left the familiar and entered the unfamiliar by the voice of the Lord. Hallelujah. And Abram journeyed, going on still toward the south, and there was a famine in the land. And Abram went down into Egypt to sojourn there. He went down, oh boy. For the famine was grievous in the land. And it came to pass, when he came near to enter into Egypt, he said unto Sarai his wife, Behold now, I know that thou art a fair woman to look upon. Therefore it shall come to pass, when the Egyptians shall see thee, they shall say, This is his wife, and they will kill me, but they will save thee alive. I think he forgot verse 2. Verse 2 says, And I will make of thee a great nation, I will bless thee, and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. Part of the stuff, part of the keys of walking with God is remembering. Remembering what, that's why he said meditate day and night to Joshua. Like meditate day and night on what the God has said, what God has said. Meditate on the scriptures, meditate on your visions, revelations, encounters with God. Meditate on God so you don't forget what he's done. Because you look at this verse here, it says, Therefore it shall come to pass, when the Egyptians shall see thee, that they will say, This is his wife, and they will kill me, but they will save thee alive. It's like once you go down into the world in Egypt, like you're having all these encounters with God. This is just this journey. Everyone's been through this, man. It's just different levels. It's like we forget the encounter, we forget the sacrifice, we forget the stretching, we forget the humbling, we forget all the blessings, and like because we're encountering fear. There's obstacles that we have to break through. So it's good. Whenever the enemy comes in like a flood, actually, you know, that scripture in Isaiah, if you just move the comma, when the enemy comes in, comma, like a flood, the Lord, you know, because there's no commas in the original Hebrew. Hallelujah. So, Shabbat, I found some sauce on that one. Oh, Shaka, glory. He forgot verse 2. He forgot the promises. So it's good to always have those, the promises of God right in the forefront of your mind and in your heart. And verse 13. Say, I pray thee, thou art my sister, that it may be well with me for thy sake, and my soul shall live because of thee. My soul shall live because of thee? What about God? See, he went down into Egypt. We need to stay up here in Christ in heavenly places, so that we don't end up going down to Egypt. We don't go to the world and like for help. These are spiritual matters. Hallelujah. Anyways, and it came to pass. I mean, this is stuff that we all go through. It's just showing the trail that we come on. There's not one of us who hasn't like looked to the world and got fearful. Is God really real? You know, is God really going to come through with his promises? We get tried. It's true, man. When Abraham was coming to Egypt, the Egyptians beheld the woman, that she was very fair. Look, he was right. This was a true threat. But sometimes we need to have God in the forefront of our mind. God needs to be more real than the threat. Hallelujah. When Abraham was coming to Egypt, Egypt here means troubles, anguish, oppresses. So when Abraham came into troubles, anguish, and oppresses, the Egyptians beheld the woman, that she was very fair. The princes also of Pharaoh saw her and commended her before Pharaoh, and the woman was taken into Pharaoh's house. Wow, look at that. You know, when you're married, you become one flesh, right? Well, look what happened when Abraham bowed to fear. His flesh became a prisoner of the world, Egypt. I wrote here, fear made Abraham's one flesh a prisoner. Yeah, you gotta watch out for fear. God's not giving us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. That's the mind of Christ. That's the love of God, the power of God. So fear will always cripple you. It will always imprison you if you give into it. Focus on the covenant promises of God and speak those out loud. Verse 16, and he entreated Abram well for her sake, and she had sheep and oxen. He had sheep and oxen, and he asses, donkeys, and men servants and maid servants, and she asses, girl camels, and camels. Girl donkeys, I mean. Oh man, help me, Holy Spirit. Those are the blessings of the world, I guess. Hallelujah. And the Lord plagued Pharaoh and his house with great plagues because of Sarai, Abraham's wife. Wow. Oh, I wrote down here, when we get crushed beyond our control, God steps in because of covenant. What a good God, eh? He steps in and just, I mean, the kings of the world. God just steps in and like, hey, back off from my boy Abraham, you know? Abram. Anyways, and Pharaoh called Abram and said, what is this that thou hast done unto me? Why didst thou not tell me she was thy wife? Why saidst thou, she is my sister, so I might have taken her to me to wife? Therefore, behold thy wife, take her and go thy way. And Pharaoh commanded his men concerning him, and they sent him away and his wife and all that he had. Chapter 13. Genesis 13. And Abraham went up. Hallelujah. He went down to Egypt. Now he went up out of Egypt. He and his wife and all that he had and Lot with him into the south. It's funny how they went up to the south. And Abraham was very rich in cattle and silver and gold. And he went on his journeys. Well, it says plural there, journeys. From the south even to Bethel, house of God, unto the place where his tent had been at the beginning between Bethel and Hai. Unto the place of the altar which he had made there at the first. And there Abram called upon the name of the Lord. When things get intense, we should always call upon the name of the Lord. Paul took it a step further. He said, pray without ceasing, man. Just live in that glory realm. So Lot also, which went with Abraham, took flocks and herds, and the land was not able to bear them, that they might dwell together, for their substance was great, so that they could not dwell together. And there was strife between the herdsmen of Abraham's cattle. It goes on. Yeah, I think we're running out of time for this video. Yeah. We'll just end it at that. Let's just do a quick recap. If you want to walk with God and be his friend, first thing that needs to go is get the fallen nature, so God can put his nature in you. You need to hear his voice, and then you need to have obedience to obey what God is saying. And then you need to keep on walking with God. Depart. Abraham departed as the Lord had spoken to him. So he stepped out in obedience, and you're going to go through some humbling. And you're going to go through some stretching. And you're going to have to sacrifice. And you're going to keep calling upon the name of the Lord. And you're going to encounter troubles, anguishes, and oppressions. But you got to keep focused on the promise, which is Jesus Christ. He's the covenant of God. He's the covenant promises of God. He's the rainbow. You know? He's the covenant promises of God. His blood is the covenant. It's the covenant of the cup. You need to drink his blood and eat his flesh. Drink his, that means communion. Commune with the life of God in your spirit in the Holy of Holies, and feast on the bread of his presence. Get stronger in the spirit. Then you can eat lamb. You can eat the meat of the gospel. You can eat deeper revelation and go into, get as deep into God as your spirit man grows. As big as you can grow your spirit man, that's how big you can feast on the Lord. That's how much lamb you can fill yourself up with. Just feasting on Him day and night. And yeah. And if you get stuck in the world, just go up. Just go up. Just go up, up, up. Up into heavenly places, out of Egypt, out of the world. Out of the worldly system of thinking, put on the mind of Christ and live in that glory realm, live in that atmosphere of peace. And if you forget what it's like, just remind yourself. Just go back to all the covenant promises that God spoke to you and spoke over you and spoke to you and through you, and just meditate on Him day and night. Everything that God has said, everything that He's said He's going to do to you, for you, and just keep on obeying, and you'll keep growing. And you'll keep glowing. All right. And may the God of peace rule and reign through your spirit. Amen.